Feely, pardon my pronunciation, I came close, I think. Close enough, as we say, with no disrespect intended. A distinguished faculty chair, College of International Security Affairs at National Defense University in the US. Then next to him, my old friend Batu Kutelia, who's with the Atlantic Council of Georgia and was the one who extended me the invitation along with Nino to be with you. So my thanks to Batu for that. And then last but not least is David Zalkoliani, Executive Director of the Levon Mikhailidze Foundation, and we're very glad to have you as well. So we actually haven't sorted out the order, except Stefan wanted to go last. Do you want to kick us off, Steve?
Sure.
Go right ahead.
So I'm hoping that these few remarks I have are responsive to the question. Grigo and I had a short conversation at dinner yesterday evening, so I think I know what I'm supposed to talk about, but I'm not completely sure.
I don't, so I won't interrupt.
So the title of this panel is New or Well Forgotten Old? And I think the answer is basically new in terms of challenges, and I want to say why. So I think if we look at international relations, let's say over the last several hundred years, basically before 1945, there were international conflicts. International conflicts were resolved by war, and if you lost the war, you lost your territory. Since 1945, there have been virtually no involuntary changes of territory. It's one reason why the annexation of Crimea was so dramatic. One or two countries where territory has actually changed. This does not, however, mean that international politics ended. But I think there are really two very different and distinct phases in the post-1945 period. During the Cold War, the Americans and the Soviets were both extremely interested in the nature of domestic regimes in other countries. But in being interested in this, they were mainly interested at the national level. We wanted people that would vote for us, the Americans in the UN, and the Soviets wanted the opposite. The United States supported some extremely problematic leaders during this period, but we thought of them as our guys. And we weren't actually very concerned about what they were doing domestically in their own country. Since the end of the Cold War, I think we actually have had a shift in transformation, where the main issues now are issues of domestic governance, and even sometimes domestic governance at the subnational level. And where the main challenge in the international environment is not conventional great power politics. Now that may be true, let me say, it may be true if we're thinking about East Asia. I do not think it's true if we're thinking about Europe. I think Russia is fundamentally a country in decline. If we can look out 30 or 40 years, I mean, Russia is certainly going to be in worse shape than it is now, unless it domestically transforms itself. It is not the case that a different regime in Russia would be worse somehow for the Russian people or even Russia writ large. A different kind of ruler could follow very different policies in ways that would be much more effective at a global level and for Russians themselves. There was a story in the New Yorker magazine about 3 years ago about a Russian teenager in Moscow who had invented an application called Chat Roulette. Okay, all of my students know what Chat Roulette is. I admit, I do not know what Chat Roulette is. So this kid actually tried to start a company in Russia, totally failed, and moved to Palo Alto. From a Russian perspective, this is absolutely disastrous. And a different kind of Russian regime could put Russia on a very different path in ways that I think would be better for all concerned, Russians, Europe, and the global community. But I think then the biggest challenge is a challenge then of domestic regimes, and I really want to echo here what David Kramer said this morning. The most important issue, I think, for Georgia is how Georgia deals with its domestic governance. I do not think you can kind of wave a magic wand and transform Georgia into Denmark in 5 or 10 years. But having better governance, more accountable governance, reasonable levels of security, some decent support for human rights, economic growth is extremely important. And just reflecting on the discussion of this morning, this issue of a situation where the old regime gets voted out and a lot of the guys are now in jail. Here's the problem. This kind of winner-take-all politics is not something that's likely to lead to stability. I don't have any kind of formula for how you should handle these issues, and it may be, in fact, that if you have an independent judiciary and the judiciary is following the law precisely as it should be followed, you can end up with the situation you have now. Nevertheless, it's not a good situation. So I think the challenge is to think about, on the path to democracy, to think about important way stations which countries might be able to reach. And I think for Georgia, and this is, I'm echoing David's comments of this morning, the most important thing for Georgia's security, in my view, is Georgia's ability to maneuver and navigate through this very treacherous path from the kind of autocracy which existed in Georgia in the past to something that looks like full-blown democracy. But that is a long and arduous path. But doing that effectively is the best protection, the best way in which Georgia can insulate itself from external threats and from Russia.
Great, Steve. Perfect on timing. We're going to skip over Stefan and go to Greg.
Thank you, David. And by the way, perfect pronunciation of my last name. So let me start with a short disclaimer that whatever I intend to say here doesn't reflect the positions of National Defense University, and I'm very glad to be less burdened by any formal position right now, so I'll clearly speak up my mind. So we have to, the hybrid warfare, I don't recall any recent meetings I have attended either in DC or in Brussels where I have not encountered this term hybrid warfare, and it increasingly became kind of a buzzword that needs to be a little bit demystified. So if we look from an angle, whether if we look to a hybrid warfare as just a combination of irregular and regular tactics, military and non-military means, then it's nothing new. And we have encountered this kind of a conflict throughout the history many times. So I want to highlight a few important characteristics of hybrid warfare that probably which Russia is waging not just against Ukraine, it waged against Georgia, but Russia is a revisionist power and wages against the free world. So I think that there are a number of characteristics that makes hybrid warfare extremely alarming for all of us. Number one is in hybrid warfare, there is no clear border, or borders are extremely blurred between the state of peace and state of war. Actually, war and warfare starts much earlier than the first bullets are shot. The second thing I think that it's equally important is that non-military means become as important as military means in contemporary conflict. This is a political and economic subversion. This is an information warfare. This is a hybrid. This is a cyber threat. So this is relatively new. It also, and another characteristic is, it also slightly challenges the very usual pattern we had towards the irregular warfare. In irregular warfare, irregular means were mainly utilized, used by a weaker side. What we are witnessing right now is that the irregular means are used and utilized extensively by a stronger side, by the Russia. So it's again, it is a relatively new characteristics of the hybrid warfare. And lastly, which is also very important, hybrid warfare gives you an ability to successfully pursue the campaign of denial. I was watching a Brussels forum just recently, and one of the leading Russian politicians very cynically was arguing 2 days ago in Brussels that there is no Russian troops in Ukraine. So again, he was capable and able to put forward this argument exactly because they are pursuing this hybrid warfare. So why should we worry about this hybrid warfare? Had the Western response be strong and unified, I don't think that that would pose a significant challenge for us. But the question is, and I spent 4 years in NATO headquarters. I know more or less internal dynamics in NATO, how it works. NATO's decision-making process was deliberately made slow because it's a Cold War institution. And how NATO is gonna respond to any threat let's say, to a similar situation as we encountered in Crimea, not clear for me. I'm glad if there are some clarity for any other panel members or for our Baltic friends or for those countries of NATO members who have a significant Russian-speaking minority. But again, it's not clear how NATO can counter these threats had we encountered a similar scenario as we did in Crimea. The second thing is that, and it's I want to echo some of the thoughts aired by the last panelist, is that I think that we, unfortunately for me, we didn't learn the lessons from the Georgian-Russian war, because at that time Russia paid almost no political price. Just in a few weeks, it went back to the business as usual in NATO. But even today, we fail, and by we I mean the U.S. and Europe or Western world, fail to raise the cost for Russian actions for violating all norms or basic fundamental international norms, but more importantly for dismembering the European nations. We are engaged in a useless semantics when we see a Russian tanks rolling towards Tbilisi. We are engaged in a useless semantics whether this is an aggression or incursion. Whenever we are debating a Budapest memorandum, we go down to a jargons like we use terms of security guarantees or assurances. So basically, we, unfortunately for me, I think that we are failing to learn those lessons. More importantly, I think that we are missing a larger point as well. We are undermining the very credibility of the fundamental idea on what the NATO is based. And this is a fundamental principle. When we are talking about enlargement, or when we are talking about the expansion of NATO, it's not just about Georgia or about Ukraine or Moldova, but at the same time, this is about the fundamental principles and documents on which this alliance was built. And if very frequently, even in the Brussels forum, we have encountered, or I have encountered, some narratives that we should find some accommodative stance towards Russia, and it can be done, by the way, by halting NATO enlargement process. So it's not just bad news for my country or for other aspirant countries, but I think that first and foremost, this is a very damaging and bad news for NATO per se. On the other hand, it's not just former politicians or academicians who are bringing up this point, but it is the leaders of a founding member of the European state. So again, that's something that I think that we clearly see that we are failing to respond to those threats. We are talking a lot about the information warfare. We don't know how to counter that. This is another challenge. But we are, more importantly for me, for a Georgian citizen, I think that today Georgia is more vulnerable towards the hybrid threats as it was years ago for two reasons. And I'll stop there. Reason number one is we have, I have seen many different political systems in this country, but I have never encountered informal leadership and unaccountable leadership. This unaccountable leadership, very peculiar form of probably Georgian democracy today, led to a very unfortunate results of IRI polls that were published just a few days ago, where we are witnessing that almost the public support towards all Georgian institutions have drastically decreased. This is the first time since many years when we see that such an institution as the Georgian army, which always had a very high credibility, now is decreased by 7%. It's not just by Georgian army, but it's a Georgian Ministry of Internal Affairs, which had experienced a drop of the 20%, but any Georgian institution today experiences the drastic drop of public support and public confidence, which makes us increasingly vulnerable in front of those threats, because those threats are not just military threats. Those threats are non-military threats as well. So I'll stop here and would be more than glad to answer any of your questions. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you, David. It's a big honor and pleasure to have an opportunity to discuss this important issue of the new hybrid challenges here in this audience. In the beginning, in the title of our panel is Hybrid Challenges, New or Well Forgotten Old. I would like to disagree with Mr. Krasner and state that it's a well forgotten old rather than new. And I'll try to make my point more clear later. But I would like to agree with Mr. Krasner on the fact that it's really hard to navigate these challenging waters for Georgia. It's hard to navigate in the absence of the proper compass and proper lighthouse. To my opinion, the lighthouse that will help us to navigate this hybrid, let's say, challenging environment is Georgia's European destiny, NATO and EU membership. And the compass that can help us to navigate is institutions, strong institutions. And I would like to echo Gega's point as well that undermining the institutions will eventually mean for Georgia not to navigate in a proper direction, but also to lose our status. And I'm not trying to exaggerate, but that might be the cost of this hybrid challenging environment. So why it's a well-forgotten old? We all who've been living through the Soviet period, we all remember how Soviet Union tried to use some kind of an immoral argument supporting the true communists or workers' class around the world. And a lot of combination of different methods have been used besides the military action. Even after the military defeats in different parts of the world, Soviet Union and Russia would proceed with the political action. And the hybrid war now as we have is nothing more than a political action against the West. So the particular military elements are the spice ups of the process, depending on the necessity of the agenda that Russian Federation has today. So therefore, the front line or the battlefield is not in Ukraine, in Georgia, but it's somewhere in the air, in the virtual space, in the minds of the audience in the Western civilized society. So the ideological pillar of the current Russia state somebody might argue that is not that strong right now than it was during Soviet Union period. But if we dig carefully, there is a strong ideological component to this hybrid warfare as well. As we see different type of statements like uniting divided people or protecting compatriots around the globe or so-called the Russian world or the Ruski Mir or this special place for the Russian civilization, which is not a Western civilization and not the Eastern civilization as well. But again, this is a part of the ideology or part of the hybrid warfare, and the main confrontation is with the European civilized democratic values. And that's why the concept Europe whole, free and at peace is so irritating to Russia. While NATO might be used as a tool for the domestic propaganda as a threat coming to the Russian interest, I personally think that it's more rhetorical argument, and the much more irritating argument for Russia was downgrading Russia to the regional power, as President Obama several times referred to Russia as a regional power. And what Russia is trying to prove now that it's not only the regional, it's a global power. And that is the reason of this snap military exercises in different parts of the world, including the Arctic Sea. And another major challenge is the economic pillar of it. So again, hybrid warfare is a new one. It's an old, well forgotten old, but with this type of, combination of hard and soft elements, of course it needs to be countered with the smart strategy. And smart strategy should be based again on the consolidating opinion in the democratic civilized world. And this political consolidation should be based on the leadership of the particular actors. And I personally think that US leadership in this regard is key. And in the conclusion, to reinforce my point that hybrid challenges is not new, but well or bad forgotten old. I just brought two documents with me here. One of them is a book that was written in 1973. The title of the book is What Everyone in the Free World Should Know About Russia. This book is written by a Georgian who emigrated to Europe and then to United States, being a cadet fighting Russian invasion in the beginning of the 20th century. And if you read this book, you will find a lot of similarities what Russia is doing today. And anatomy of Russian behavior has not been changed. And another document also I brought with me is the White House document, which was secret until 2008. It's a National Security Decision Directive number 75, which describes President Reagan's administration's approach to the Soviet Union. And here you could see the hybrid strategy to counter hybrid challenges caused by the Soviet Union at that time. So if you read this document and instead of Soviet Union you put Russia, you have a perfect strategy how to counter hybrid challenges that we face today. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Vasily. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's a pleasure and honor for me to be here and to speak in front of this distinguished audience about the hybrid challenges we are facing today. I think that it's obvious that what we are facing today is a value-based confrontation. And we should acknowledge that this confrontation will continue for a long time. And I think that Georgia should be prepared for a long struggle. Of course, our northern neighbor is categorically against of these values and is trying to undermine the democratization processes in the neighboring countries, especially those who are striving for building up democratic societies. We have already been attacked by hybrid warfare or asymmetric warfare in early 90s when the whole world was witness how Russia helped to create a separatist regime to use them as a justification to invading Georgia, and which was resulted in 2008 by the occupation of more than 20% of Georgian territories. Our choice of Euro-Atlantic integration, of course, is not in line with the Russian strategy to re-establish and re-establish its influence over the so-called post-Soviet space by Eurasian Union. And at the same time, we should also acknowledge that after the enlargement of EU and the NATO, there was a kind of stereotype formed in Europe and among our NATO allies that the Russia will categorically oppose to the NATO enlargements to East, but will be less sensitive towards the Eastern Partnership process. But what we have witnessed in Ukraine, dramatic developments in Ukraine, it's a clear example that for Russia, it was extremely difficult to get used with even with the fact of signing of association agreement. We are all aware that the association Eastern Partnership is not the end process, and it does not guarantee these countries to be full-fledged members of the European Union. Now I will try to focus and give my analysis about that. By the way, this word analysis is very popular in the current date Georgian realities, and I will try to focus on several directions of or dimensions of possible threats coming and challenges coming to Georgia. First of all, it's an internal political dimension, and here objective is to polarize population and to diminish efficiency and legitimacy of the ongoing political democratization process in the country. And Russia has different instruments and tools how to reach this goal, by the way, by increasing financial aid and support to the groups and political parties who are affiliated or associated with the with Russia, or for example, activate propaganda machine and to generate negative approach towards European values, actively instrumentalize Georgian diaspora in the Russian Federation, and also use some ethnic factors, especially in the areas populated by ethnic minorities in Georgia. Second dimension and second direction, I believe, is the external dimension, and here the objective is to discredit Georgia's credibility in the West, just portraying Georgia as an unstable state which can bring some additional problems to NATO and EU member states, and also to continue to block some important decisions, for example, in international organizations, by supporting Georgia's territorial integrity, especially those in organizations where Russia has right of veto, especially UN and the OSCE. Third dimension is very important dimension, but who has already talked about the economic dimension. And I think that in the first panel, there was a discussion about the championship and competition, and one cannot deny that Russia is championing using its economic tools and leverages to get some political gains, and which was the case back in 2006 when we all witnessed the mass expulsion of Georgian population from Russian Federation and introducing a trade embargo, etc. Russia can also instrumentalize the CIS member states just to convince them to rethink about their strategy, especially economic strategy, and revise bilateral trade agreements with Georgia. After withdrawing from the CIS, Georgia maintained bilateral free trade agreements with all of them. And I think here the role of the government is important to promote the DCFTA, which is the more than 80% of this agreement is already in provisional application, and it's a big opportunity, big chance for country to modernize our economy. And I think the government should intensify its work in this dimension. Fourth is the military direction, and it's a very dangerous development in the region, and Russia is increasing its military presence in the neighboring bordering regions, and just yesterday there was they have launched a large-scale military drills and maneuvers in the Stavropol region, including the forces who are now stationed on the occupied territories in Abkhazia and Tsinghali region. And numerous provocations which we have witnessed during the last period, especially violation of Georgian airspace by Russian drones and unidentified helicopters. This installation of barbed wire fences across the occupation line dividing families, denying them to have access to the agricultural work, and restriction to freedom of movement, and things like this. And also this fifth dimension the threats and challenges coming from the occupied territories and recent signing of so-called integration agreements with Abkhazia and Tsinghali region is of clear evidence of this. And it's a signal to Georgia, it's a signal to West, our partners, that if Georgia continues to move towards NATO and European Union, then this is the response of Russian Federation, that there will be further annexation of these territories. Last but not least is the manifestation of soft power. It's an instrument for manipulation of the sentiments of the local population, and here is they are promoting an idea that Georgia's integration in the European Union and NATO will completely eliminate any chance of restoration of Georgia's territorial integrity. Also, they are using such instrument as Georgian Orthodox Church, creating expectation in Georgia, like that high-level contacts between hierarchy between Russian Orthodox and Georgian Church will bring some results regarding the restoration of our territorial integrity of the occupied territories. And also the visa regime. One cannot exclude that Russia can suddenly lift visa-free regime, visa restrictions with Georgia, while we are all waiting for the Riga summit. But unfortunately, European Union is dragging its feet to give Georgia visa free regime, and Russia can easily manipulate here and can grant a visa free to Georgians living in Russian Federation, thus gaining their hearts and the hearts of their relatives living in Georgia. And finally, I think we have to think how to resist all these challenges, how to reply to it, what should be state response. I think that the answer is very simple. We have to, the government and the Georgian society has to be very firm and consistent to continue reforms and to strengthen state institutions, to consolidate the whole society for the democratization processes, to build vibrant society with the free media, eradicate all problems in our economy, improve social environment and democratic institutions. And also, last but not least, not to be very careful and not to give any chance to Russian security services and its proxies to freely feel free in Georgia regarding all these challenges. Thank you very much.
There was a reference to the EU there. I think it's a good segue over to you.
It's strange, so I'm not representing the European Union here. But let me, David, let me start thanking the organizers, I mean, to include me in this interesting third panel on such a short notice. It gives me an opportunity to make it very clear in front of you that my European Commission experience has not been an isolated event in my professional career. And then I remain committed to engagement with the partners, and particularly the one in this part of Europe. It also provides me with an opportunity to express myself clearly once again, even in my position of former, to the territorial integrity of Georgia and to the European aspiration of Georgia. But coming to the issue we're debating, let me address this through the four remarks. Someone smart in the previous panel said, this is not a thunderstorm, this is a climate change. I cannot agree more. This is a climate change. Those who believe that we will find a solution to the current situation in a couple of months or years might be mistaken. I hope I'm mistaken, but I am afraid that we are facing this new situation for a number of years, if not decades. Now, the hybrid war, hybrid conflict, hybrid instrument. Its danger is that it challenges this rule-based approach to the international security. It actually creates the impression that the international order is still there, but it allows you to take your case outside of that order. The second remark is we need to see this hybrid warfare and war within the larger context, because it's connected to this revisionistic policy of Kremlin, to the post-Cold War European order. It's combined with the propaganda, which is, I would say, far more dangerous than the one we had known from the Cold War. But this one does not stop on the Iron Curtain. This one mobilizes. And this one, compared to the previous one, does not sort of attempt or create the impression that the situation is black and white and tries on the ideological basis to persuade others that I have the truth. No, this one is questioning everything we think about. It's questioning the way we set up our values. It's questioning the way how we perceive the truth and the relative around us. And it is in that environment when you start to doubt the propaganda is, in fact, extremely not only effective, but dangerous. But there is another element no one has mentioned so far, and it is the role of the nuclear weapons, or rather I should add, the lowering the threshold for not only threatening, but also actually using the nuclear weapons together as a part of this new hybrid concept. The point number three, which has been already made by my colleagues in the panel, but let me stress it again, that the hybrid challenges or the hybrid war is not only about the external threat. It's about internal too, through the various elements of it. It moves the public opinion in our countries in a wrong direction. So, and it undermines, or helps to undermine, the democratic institutions in our countries. Now, the point number four is we do not need just analysis. We also need to do something about it. We should not accept the Putin's rules of the games here and establish our own. So it means, first of all, to acknowledge that there is this new situation and security, to acknowledge it. And I'm saying that because I see still a number of politicians in the European Union even not ready to do that. We need to build the resilience, it has been also said earlier today, and we need to coordinate, we need to work together. But we need also establishing those new rules of the games to reactivate the OSCE. It has once helped to build the bridges, and I dare to say we need those bridges here again, while there is still a river or something to build the bridge across. We need to strengthen this European security house. But we need also to be more creative in addressing the issues like the relationship between the European Union and Eurasian Economic Union. Of course there are clear preconditions for that, like establishing the stability in this part of Europe, particularly in the Eastern Ukraine. Another one could be to use the WTO principles to talk about any eventual free trade agreement between the EU and the Euro-Asian Economic Union. But this is the only way how we could avoid this Putin trick, pushing the countries between Moscow and Brussels to make a choice here. And that leads me to the conclusions. Hybrid war challenges our weaknesses, and our response should not be of a hybrid character. So I know that the politics has more than 50 shades of gray to offer, but this one is about white or black, because after all, there are no such things as a hybrid values or hybrid rules. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If someone has a microphone out there, if I could get it, I'm going to roam around a little bit, but I want to involve the audience, but I want to direct some questions to the panel as well. So, Stefan, let me start with you, actually. Yeah, can I have that? So, Stefan, your comments, which I very much appreciate, were very good, very hard-hitting, very clear. But I think a lot of people in this room are concerned that they don't reflect a unified EU position, that there are a lot of splits and division within Europe, vis-a-vis Georgia, vis-a-vis Russia, Ukraine, of course. Can you give us sort of an insider's perspective on how things look? Because people are concerned about some specific countries and the positions they have, and worried that Russia is in fact trying to pull a few individual countries away to reduce the possibility of a unified approach. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, I can. Three elements. Yeah, there were the times where Kremlin, Putin in particular, could divide the European Union. But after the Lisbon Treaty, he had in front of him, behind the negotiating table, not a head of the state of the presiding country, and each and every 6 months a different one. He was having two presidents each and every time there was a summit, with a certain institutional memory and ready to challenge him. So I would say, first of all, that it's more difficult, actually, for Russia today to divide the European Union. Second point is, I don't agree, despite all the odds and despite the many comments and speculations, that there is really a huge division within the European Union. Actually, on the contrary, I've never seen the European Union member states being united on the most strategic and critical issues like the relations with Russia. But what is the problem, and where I see the problem, we have not been able to translate that unity into the unity of actions led by the EU institutions. That's what is missing. And this third element, I hope very much that we are not making a mistake in the European Union with the new institution, the new commissions, looking at the past, saying, it has been disaster in our neighborhood, means our policy has been disaster, so it needs to be changed, everything. And in the meantime, we have enough of the domestic challenges. We need to address, first of all, them. It's not going to work. You cannot address the external or internal challenges at the expense of the external ones. It has been a lesson learned. I thought we have already recognized in the past, and I hope very much we will not make that mistake this time, at this critical time.
Thank you. Steve, let me turn to you. The question I have for you is about the information war that's underway. What, in your view, is the best way for Georgia, the United States, for Europe to respond to this? Is it tit for tat, a kind of propaganda campaign in response? Is it making sure the truth gets out there? Is it ignoring it? What's the best way, in your view?
Wow, so, you know, my real answer would be, really, David, I have no idea.
Okay, next question.
You know, I think that the question is, I think the main impact is not so much the effectiveness of propaganda, but the way in which these different countries are functioning. So the one thing that, for me, is optimistic about this arena is I think Russia's really in deep trouble, and it's not going to get out of this deep trouble. Population's declining. It's an autocratic regime. It's highly dependent on natural resources. It's deeply corrupt. And that seems to me more important. Now, it's not that the United States is doing so great either, but that seems to me to be more important. That is, the actual domestic functioning of these different polities seems to be more important than propaganda per se. But I could be wrong.
Before turning to your... Go ahead, Grigol. Yeah.
Well, on information warfare, I think that what we shouldn't do, and by we, I mean U.S. and free world, is you cannot counter Putin by becoming Putin yourself. However, there are some very concrete tools that you can use against those people who are engaged in this information warfare. For instance, all of those media representatives who work for Russia today, I think that if there is a consensus in the mainstream media that all of those journalists who work today in Russia today, they ensure that it is a last job for them, then I think that we at least increase the cost for serving Putin's information or Kremlin's information machinery. So what you shouldn't do is to become someone as you are trying to oppose, but on the other hand, there are very concrete tools you can use against those who are engaged in the information warfare.
Batu, go ahead. Yeah, sure.
Just a very brief point about the information warfare, because it affects Georgia's daily life and Georgia's state building. We have now propaganda, but more adapted to new realities. It's called the Propaganda Plus, which is much more similar to the terrorist strategy, while propaganda and information tools are used to terrorize target audiences. So therefore, the best way, I mean, there might not be a good answer how to target that propaganda, but definitely how we deal with the terrorists, that should be the same approach towards dealing Russia as a country who applies the terroristic methods to achieve its ultimate political goals.
I want to take an informal survey of the audience before turning my next question to our Georgian panelists. How many of you here are concerned or nervous that within, say, the next 12 months, you may see Russian troops once again crossing the Georgian border? Wow. Okay. I would say a pretty clear majority.
Maybe tomorrow.
Well, I'm leaving Saturday, so if we could wait until then. I'll be with you, but from the air. So in light of that reaction, I want to ask the three of you, David, start with you. How serious are those concerns, and what can Georgia do about them?
I'm also part of this audience who believes that Russians can invade, it's a very serious issue. And I have mentioned in my remarks about this continued maneuvers and drills every day, and these large-scale military operations. And we have just occupied forces in 40 kilometers from Tbilisi. That's why I think that what should we do? And I think that especially the responsibility of the government is to continue the military reforms, to be more consistent on asking our partners and allies to give Georgia defense capabilities. And also to create a solid ground here, internal political situation, not to give any chance Russian Federation to have any the possibility to be provoked Georgia and to invade in Georgia. So, and I think that in one sentence, the simple answer is to act as we are already NATO ally. So this is my answer to your question.
Well, I would like to join majority in this audience in terms of assessing probability. But what we see in terms of the military campaigns that Russia is doing is a more symptom rather than the cause of the problem. The cause, as I mentioned, is much more fundamental in terms of the clash of the values of the free world and the oppressing revanchist regime in Russia. Therefore, when and where this symptom will occur, it's hard to judge. We have to expect it anywhere and any place, depending on the tactical needs in terms of achieving some greater, let's say, political goals. And there is no institution in Russia who makes this decision. These decisions are brewed in one ill-inflamed brain. That's why I personally think that to contain Russia and make this process reversible in terms of the use of force, there needs to be very clear and coherent strategy besides strengthening and reinforcing Article 5 for the NATO defense, but extending this type of, let's say, security guarantees or security assistance or those who are in need of helping them increase their self-defense capabilities and making this as a cornerstone of the policy containing and reversal of the Russian aggression. Only through this type of proactive and not in a reactive policy, we can contain this problem and in the long run have an effective strategy of ensuring that the free world will not face any additional military adventures, including use of the nuclear weapon, which quite often is aired by so-called Russian experts time to time, as an option for the next step for the Russia in terms of capitalizing on particular tactical gains that they have already got through occupying parts of Georgian territory, occupying Crimea, and now challenging Ukraine and its state.
Well, three quick points. First, we should keep Georgia high on the radar screen of our Western allies and partners, and I think that our diplomacy is failing in this direction. I think that Georgia is increasingly disappearing from our strategic allies' agenda, and this is one of the weaknesses that our diplomacy is displaying right now. Second thing is we should not, as a society and as a Georgian society, we should not tolerate an informal leadership in this country. Otherwise, we will witness the further degradation of our institutions. We have already witnessed, as I mentioned, a significant drop of public confidence in all major institutions. If we continue tolerating informal leadership in this country and this form of governing the state, then we have to be ready to encounter not just military threats, but non-military threats, and Russians are very effective in that. And three, the third is we should stop confusing our partners, because when our prime minister comes and says that our Ukrainian partners should not get a defense capabilities, and then on the other day we are asking to our main partners that we as a Georgian should get a defense capabilities. To put it mildly, the message is very confusing. So we should be more consistent. We should we shouldn't have a realistic, programmatic approach, but we should stick to the values as well that I did resonate and echo one of the speakers of the previous panel. And we at least can minimize the risks that we are facing right now. Thank you.
And I like very much your second point, because we cannot talk about the hybrid wars and warfare, by the same time then to think like we were thinking before in terms of the own invasion could be accomplished through the tanks and so on. No. I would say that would be on the bottom of the long list of how the Kremlin could influence the domestic situation here in Georgia. And I would say that it would not be productive, I mean, to focus only on the military threat in the meaning of the Second War and or even 2008 war here. But I think we need to think based on this new situation there are many more challenges, many more ways how the situation here could be influenced. I'm not only here.
Okay, let's open it up for questions from the audience. Go over here.
Thank you. Mamuka Kudala. I belong to the public movement, Tiberia, which started several months ago campaign against Russian TVs, which were forbidden since Russia-Georgia war, but the new government reinstalled those propagandist channels 2 years ago. The idea is to employ all means available to ban them again. Why? Because first, they infringe on our territorial integrity and sovereignty, and second, they incite hate and hatred, etc. This information, but the question is about another element of hybrid warfare beyond the information war, which is very much employed by the Kremlin currently, mostly in Europe, not, to my knowledge, in too much in states yet. This is financing European extreme parties to use them as additional tool in disinformation warfare. And my question would be to non-Georgian speakers, well, how much that can be sold, or how much that is important? We have already some results, negative results, I think. One government that came to power in European state, in Greece, which is very, very pro-Kremlin. Others are resurgence of other parties in major countries, including France, UK, now already in Germany, Spain as well. How we should counter that, and whether there are some opportunities for the states as well to play some role.
Stefan, you know, we just had in St. Petersburg a gathering of nuts. I mean, dangerous people, I would say, including a few from the United States. What about this factor, the Russian attempt to influence politics in Europe through funding support for right-wing?
It is there, and it is a part of this new hybrid spectrum, and that's why I refer to it, and that's why I talked about propaganda. I think it has acquired a little bit larger meaning. I have been shocked to find out after the last elections of the European Parliament that actually not only you have more representative of extreme right and left in the parliament. I was also surprised how much, to what extent they are used to use the rhetoric of the Kremlin propaganda. I presume that the Kremlin propaganda has offered quite a comfortable wagon for the extremists and populists on both sides. It is a big issue. I see it in my own country, the Czech Republic. The impact of the Russian propaganda, the Russian servers. And again, the most dangerous thing is that it does not challenge you in what you believe, the right or wrong. It challenges the way you think and you perceive the things around you. And I have seen a lot of former colleagues who I always respected, but asking me the question I have never thought they would ask me. Even them, they have started to doubt in the obvious.
Steve, before turning to the next question, let me just pick up on the first point that the gentleman raised about the views and treatment of Russian quote-unquote journalists. The EU added to the sanctions list Dmitry Kiselyov, who's one of the lead Kremlin propagandists, but the United States has not put him on or any other. How would you recommend dealing with our people work at RT, Voice of Russia, these kinds of things? Ban them, as some countries are trying to do. Estonia, for example, has decided not to take that approach. What would you recommend?
I think we need to be very comprehensive in that approach. I think, and I agree, that if there are a clear proof that here or there, the broadcasting has violated the law, I think then the justice needs to be ensured. At the same time, just banning them is not a solution. So we need to strengthen our own capacity not to fight bad propaganda with another bad propaganda, because there is nothing like a good propaganda. But we need to strengthen our capacity to present the truth, and our capacity to address the half true and sometimes this this hiding the truth behind a certain facet. We are not good in that. In my last weeks in the Brussels, I have tried to strengthen the capacity of the EU institutions every second day to be on the RT and to present not through the EU speak, but speaking with Russian language or using the Russian language, but addressing the issues how we see them. And the last things which I think needs to be done, I don't believe establishing our own Russian-speaking televisions and radios as a competition to the RT. There's no match as of today to what the Russians have invested in this area. But we have a much stronger instrument there. And one of them is actually to make a network of all those TVs, radios, servers, NGOs, and people willing to fight the lies, to fight it together, to strengthen each other argument, to use each other argument, to reinforce the messages. After all, the truth is on our side.
American perspective on this, too?
This is an area in which I have no expertise, but I'm skeptical of the idea that somehow the manipulation of propaganda is going to solve the problem. I mean, if you look at people's opinions in the United States, if you look at different groups in the country, I mean, you can see radically different views about what's happening based on people's own experience, to some extent reinforced by what they can find in the internet. But it seems to me that the issue here, as you say, I mean, the truth is on our side. I think it depends critically on performance. Maybe this is naive on my part, but even if RT is somehow a very effective propaganda machine, I'm not sure how much of a net impact it can have outside of what people are actually experiencing. I mean, if you look at the Ukraine, I mean, the fact is this was not a very well-functioning regime. It's not, people in the Crimea weren't doing so great. The Tatars reacted very differently from the Russian-speaking population in the Crimea. So I'm not sure that thinking about this as a technical problem in which we can somehow get better propaganda or, you know, identify journalists who we might decide to ban, I'm not sure that would have that much of a net impact.
David,
but again, I could be wrong.
You wanted to jump in quickly.
I want to add, regarding how to deal with this propaganda, I think that in addition of what was said here, we have here, the government has very good tool, which unfortunately it's not used effectively. For example, the communication strategy, which is elaborated together with European Union, and is, instead of use this mechanism, this instrument effectively, and to travel into different regions, especially regions populated by ethnic minority, and to speak about all these benefits, about the European values, about NATO, EU integration. Unfortunately, government is blaming the NGOs and the opposition parties who are very actively promoting Georgia's the NATO aspiration and all these Western values. So I think there is lack of political will from the government, and this intentionally or unintentionally gives solid ground for those NGOs and some civil groups who are advocating Russian values here in Georgia.
Thanks. We're going to collect three questions here. Here, over there.
I have one comment and one question. A comment on Batu's speech that we see the lighthouse and there is the compass needed, but also the captain is needed who can drive the boat and find the compass, not only domestically, but on the international level as well. So we have the lack of leadership that we can see, monitoring of daily news, international media, and etc. Strong international leadership that is needed today. My question is regarding the strong and clear messages that would help us in order to conduct the and implement the communication strategy that was written together with EU and with other non-governmental organizations. First of all, here are my two previous ministers, so, and I would like to say the words of appreciation or support for both of them. Mr. Georgi Baramidze, Mr. Alex Petriashvili, who always were great supporters in order to conduct the active public campaign, talking and conducting public dialogue with the public in Georgia, in Tbilisi, in the region, in the villages. And I should mention here my current minister, who is also very actively supporting our activities and initiatives. Sometimes the problem is coming from the international speakers from NATO, honestly speaking, speakers from EU. For example, in previous session, I wanted to address this question to the Mr. Whiteside, but there was not enough time. He mentioned that Georgia will get the NATO membership according to the Bucharest Summit Declaration if Georgia fulfills the reforms. When we have the meetings with the students, basically, the questions is the pretty much same. What is there left that Georgia should implement, should achieve in order to receive the NATO membership? My answer is that there is nothing. We are almost there. There is only lack of the political consensus in NATO. So during the previous session, Mr. Whiteside mentioned that the, Georgia should fulfill the requirements and then we will receive the membership. My question is here, so which statement is right? What should I tell to the students, students in the school, in the regions, people? Georgia should fulfill the requirements, no matter of Russian obstacle and Russia stopping the...
Russia stopped your microphone.
Conspiracy again.
Exactly.
So, which is the right? Georgia should fulfill the requirements, no matter the Russia's pressure and stopping from the successful road to the membership, and will get membership, or the international society should overcome Russia's movement and overcome this problem for Georgia to get the membership. So, these two, if I, thank you.
My Hello? Okay. My name is Deborah Wild. I'm a freelance journalist. It's been suggested by the panel to punish journalists who work for Russia Today. I have colleagues who work for Russia Today. My suggestion is, instead of making the first step to punish journalists, start paying for quality journalism in your own countries. Less journalists might go to work for Russia Today if they're paid decently. First step, subscribe to a newspaper of your own choice. Spend money, because quality journalism costs. It's not for nothing.
Thank you. I'm still under the impression of the hypothetical question, you know, and I want to put the hypothetical, a little bit provocative question. We all witnessed and followed the developments in Russia recently after the murder of opposition leader Boris Nemtsov. There were a lot of rumors, speculations about the internal battles between the law enforcement agencies and the Kadyrovs, the other very strong wing in under the Putin's rulership. So let us imagine that one day the price for the barrel is $10. Russia's economy is collapsing, and Russia is falling apart. It's not totally unrealistic, but I want to hear from our dear European and American friends, what will be the strategy of the democratic community to help Russia to preserve Russian Federation, to leave it alone to fall apart, and what will be the strategy in regard to the aspiring countries like Georgia, Ukraine, and Moldova?
Thank you. I represent the same organization as Mamuka Kudava, organization in Iberia, which fights the legal fight, we're at the beginning of it anyway, to ban Russian state TV channels in Georgia. Yet I think that it's not a panacea, because, you know, Georgia alone and banning TV programs here probably won't neutralize Russian international warfare instruments here, because those channels will be available by satellites, by computer, internet, etc., etc. I'm pretty sure that some people in this room remember that Russian language journal called America, which was founded by State Department. It was during Soviet period. And that journal was distributed mainly to Russian and Communist Party members and, you know, Soviet bureaucracy. Yet that little thing, which was, you know, just describing everyday life in America, did huge difference. You know, it was very effective soft power instrument that State Department used to counter then existing Soviet propaganda, which has gone since then. But right now, Russian propaganda is, you know, quite much more shrewder, you know, much more smarter. They do not try to portray Russian way of life as better than Americans. They just say that they try to, you know, discredit the West as, you know, materialistic, greedy, manipulative, anti-traditional, you know, you name it, list goes on and on. So they just don't claim that we are the good guys, but they say in very subtle ways that, you know, they're also the bad guys. So there is no real difference between me, Putin, and the West. And that works a lot. And I can say that seeing examples in this country. And I'm also a former Minister of Culture of this country in previous government, and I know how much cultural budget is allocated from State Department to your embassy here. It's ridiculously low. So my point is, and my question is, isn't it a good idea to somehow use American and Western soft power instruments, like technology, like innovations, like cultural things, to influence, not influence, but counter Russian propaganda with, you know, truthful images of products that freedom created. You know, it could be technology, it could be, as I said, arts, it could be anything. It's not used at all by West now. And that could be, and I would like to know if you could elaborate on that. If it could be, you know, adequate remedy to Russian propaganda. Thank you.
Start, Steve. Let's just go down the line. So we've got NATO, we have journalism, we have Russian collapse, and then soft power culture.
I'm just going to do the Russian collapse question. I think this really depends critically on whether there's someone in these countries that you can bet on. So would the West let Russia collapse? No, not if there are elements in Russia that you could see could be supported in ways that would lead to a more constructive outcome. But if there's no one to bet on, it's very hard, I think, to implement an effective foreign policy.
I think I agree that our reply to propaganda, and I make that reference, should be comprehensive. Everything what will sort of move us from this defensive posture in which we are now should be tested, should be considered, and should be used. Another point about collapsing Russia, I don't think that it is in our interest. I don't think we should be a part of the arrangement which will push the Russians in that corner without defining the exit strategy of our own liking and based on our own rules of game. Because collapsing Russia and push deep into the corner is dangerous for Russia, not only towards its own citizens, but vis-a-vis the whole Europe and the world. I take your point about money and the journalists. Absolutely, it's one part of that comprehensive approach. NATO membership. I was in Bucharest in 2008, and I'm not to tell the truth. And some you might not like what I'm going to say. I'm not proud of what we have done in Bucharest, because we have changed the rules of the game. So we have promised the membership, but we have not shown the road to the membership. Instead of focusing on that road and adopting the membership action plan, we created the impression which has been misperceived by some politicians, including in this country, as Georgia being on its way to get the Article 5 guarantees, and it allows Putin the second day in the framework of NATO-Russia Council say, oh, you want Ukraine in NATO? Well, it's an artificial country. That's where he used that word. And I think this is also where he has learned that we were bluffing. And it took him only a couple of months before, you know what. So I'm not questioning the aspirations. I'm questioning the way how to get there. I think that was it.
Stefan, cannot agree more on your assessment of the Bucharest Summit's outcome, so I won't go to this part of the question. On media, on journalists, I still think that we are in a market economy, and I do hope that our government won't regulate the wages of the journalists as well. So I wish that our journalists were well paid. as the other people or other representatives of other working groups as well. On the other hand, we all bear responsibilities to what we are doing, and I do still think that working for Russia today and all of those people who are working Russia today, they bear a responsibility as well. If you are, let's say, and there were a lot of, which is, thank you, Gia. And let's presume that any Russian enters the Russian intelligence service. So I don't think that any Russian who enters FSB aspires to become a member of any other international organization. So I think that entering Russia today has to bear some price because, again, we all are responsible what we are serving for. So that's my point. And I still do think that there is no one who will pick up your point and will introduce a new regulations because we have seen many regulations in recent months. So I don't think that regulating the wages won't add to the list of the already. Excuse me?
Let's move on. Let's not. Okay, you can carry that offline. I do, but
yeah, I do as well. I subscribe to Washington.
Anyway, it's a business competing with state.
Right.
Just about a few quick points. First, I think the winning strategy in fighting this new or well forgotten old challenges is to have a proactive strategy rather than being in a reactive mode. So while it's important to try to understand what Russia will do or what is in Putin's mind, I think more important is to figure out what we want to do as a free world, what are the values we are prepared to defend, and what are the values for what we are willing to sacrifice some of our, let's say, comfort or, let's say, the daily life which creates a, the comfort for our societies. So that's my first point. The second point is what Nick mentioned, is a Russian propaganda message that they really are trying to perceive that they are not good ones, but Russia is a strong one, so those who will be with Russia, Russia delivers the results. And it's really easy to be a bad player rather than the good player. This is, by the way, the message of the pro-Russian politicians here in Georgia domestically are projecting as well. They say that, yeah, all of the politicians in the spectrum are one way or another connected to Russians, but let's say, as Burjanadze mentioned, I am connected on the top of the Russian leadership, so that's why I am your choice, and the Americans and NATO, they are distant. On the leadership side, I think, and I mentioned in my initial remarks, that US leadership will be decisive. I think because the degree or the proportion of the idealism versus pragmatism in the US political spectrum is much greater than in Europe, unfortunately. That's why Russian propaganda got a less traction in the US and more traction in the European part of the free world. And lastly, it's not only important to contain Russia right now, while this should be a tactical goal, but in a strategic terms, it should be important to maintain and create a system that would prevent Russia any time in the foreseeable future to reestablish itself as an aggressive revisionist power. So with this in mind, of course, the key focus relies on the leadership, and here, once again, I would like to repeat that U.S. leadership will be decisive.
Very brief, I just want to echo what was said by Mr. Rulua regarding the soft power from our Western allies. Of course, so we are, my perception is that we are missing the more engagement of our American partners and the European Union regarding the more visibility and showing the elements of soft power, and I think that it should be intensified in the nearest future. Thank you.
Just in wrapping up, let me just say I agree with Stefan's assessment on 2008 Bucharest. Another part that Ted left out this morning is you then have to get agreement among all NATO allies to accept an aspiring state. And that obviously is a rather steep hill to climb. On Russian collapse, I think I share Steve's assessment that Russia's in trouble, and I think Russia is heading over a cliff. Our challenge, I think, is not to stop that, because I don't think we have the means to do so. Putin seems determined to keep driving until he goes off. I think our task is to make sure he doesn't take another country with him, whether it's Ukraine or Georgia. And then lastly, on journalism, I do subscribe to newspapers, but I also have a personal policy of never doing an interview with RT. I don't think it's useful, and I think it plays right into their hands, although I do respect Stefan's ability to push back on them. I think that can also be effective given the position that he was in. Please join me in thanking our panel, and I believe we have a coffee break for 15 minutes, and then we'll come back for the last panel.